Alright, happy to see you. Welcome to this Node.js series. So what I want to do with this series is to try and teach you Node.js the way I wish I was taught, pretty much. So we'll start from the beginning. We'll learn what is Node.js made of, how it really works behind the surface, and then we'll progress onto learning more about different pieces of Node.js, such as its ecosystem, the NPM, the core and the third-party modules, how modules work, and more. Now, who is this series for? Well, the interesting thing perhaps about this series is that it is primarily geared towards newcomers, so for the people who want to learn the Node.js for the first time ever. However, that said, I'll go into great depth when explaining how things really work behind the surface, so I genuinely believe that even if you have spent some time or maybe like a lot of time writing or using Node.js, you can still learn a thing or two by watching this series, or at the very least you'll brush up on the basics, or you'll get yourself reminded on something that you knew but perhaps have forgotten. So if you're either in one of those two categories, I think you'll benefit from watching this series. Well, hopefully at least. Okay, so what is Node.js anyway? So if you do some googling and you try to figure out what is Node.js by reading different articles, you'll usually stumble upon these four bullet points. Now, when you read them the first time and you don't follow up with some examples, you probably don't really grasp the details of these four points. But don't worry, in this video we'll do exactly that. So first I'm going to go through them, and then on the next slides we're going to take a look at each of these in more depth, and hopefully you will totally understand what it means. So to get started, it is a runtime environment for running JavaScript codes. Now this is really important to know, because many people mistake Node.js for another language or like another framework. So for example, you can't really compare Node.js to say C#, or to Java, or to even JavaScript, and you really can't say that you prefer, say, Ruby on Rails more than Node.js and vice versa, because those two aren't comparable out of the box, and you indeed have different frameworks in the Node.js. So it is not a framework and it is not a language, it is an environment where your written JavaScript code actually gets run. Next, pretty soon you'll learn that this runtime environment is actually built on top of Chrome's V8 JavaScript engine, and it simply means that Node.js kinda takes that V8 JavaScript engine and then implements a lot of different things next to it, and all of that encapsulated is that Node.js runtime. Then you read about some great stories about how it is really fast and you can build a scalable web applications. You read about stories where companies adopted Node.js, replaced their old infrastructure, and were able to like cut the amount of their servers like by half and get like much more concurrent connections and save some expenses and stuff like that. So it is great for that. Now it also uses an event-driven non-blocking IO model, and what this means is that those expensive operations like talking to the database or like talking to your file disk system, those can take some time, okay? So what Node.js does, it queues those operations on a thing called event queue, and then only when those operations are finished, it executes code corresponding with those results, and it's not like blocking your entire code execution because loading up a file takes 2 seconds, for example. So we'll also learn more about this in depth. It's really one of the more interesting characteristics of Node.js. So let's dive a bit deeper into the meaning of runtime environment. So let's imagine that you open your favorite web browser. It can be Chrome, it can be Firefox, or it can be Internet Explorer. I don't know you personally, so I won't make any assumptions there. So you open that browser, and that browser contains a JavaScript engine inside of it. And the job of JavaScript engine is to parse the website's JavaScript code and to actually execute it. Now, all of those web browsers have different JavaScript engines. So for example, on Chrome, we have something called V8 that I already told you about. And And for the Firefox, they have a JavaScript engine that is called SpiderMonkey. And the Internet Explorer has something called Chakra, if I'm not mistaken. So the main point here is that like different browsers contain this different JavaScript engine. And that's also the reason why the same code can be slightly different depending on where you actually open that site. So now you might be wondering like what is this JS engine and why it exists. So the main purpose behind this JavaScript engine is to take the code that you write in JavaScript programming language and to convert it to something that is called machine code. And on the next slide, we'll see why that's important. Okay, so as it turns out, the device you're currently watching me has a CPU. Now, a CPU stands for Central Processing Unit, and it is more known simply as processor. And this thing over here doesn't speak JavaScript, okay? In fact, it doesn't even speak Java or C Sharp or whatever. It just knows how to understand this machine code over here. Now, the machine code is really comprised of just ones and zeros, as it is in binary, and right now we are kind of in that weird world where we are talking about electricity, we're talking about different logic gates on the actual processing chip. There is really only two states over there. It can either be like on, meaning the current is passing through it, and it can be off, meaning the current is blocked. So there is no way you and I would actually write this machine code directly. That would be a really painful experience, and it would be so slow and awful, really. So we invented something called higher level programming languages, and we're going to learn about them in the next slide. Okay, so speaking of all those different programming languages, we can imagine a sort of like inverted pyramid, and on the bottom we have the actual CPU, next to it we have machine code, which are all ones and zeros, it's binary code over here. Next we have something called object code, which is pretty close to the machine code, but it's not quite there really. And then we start seeing all those languages that we are familiar with, like C, C++, Java, C Sharp, JavaScript, Ruby, Python, etc. Now you can pretty much categorize most of these languages as high-level programming languages, but I did make this distinction primarily because like in C and C++, they are also used for writing system applications because they are also really low-level programming languages because you can deal with memory yourself. They don't have garbage collection. Java and C Sharp are probably somewhere in between those two categories, and on top I simply put dynamically typed programming languages such as JavaScript, Ruby, Python, etc. Now, the more close you get to the CPU and you use the programming language which is more close towards the CPU, the more performance you usually get out of it, and the more you steer away from it, you get nicer developer experience, for example, but your code usually runs way slower. Okay, now with Node.js, it's not really that simple because as you can tell, we don't see Node.js here, we see just JavaScript. But now we'll actually go back to the runtime environment idea, and with this newly acquired knowledge, we'll now try to make all things connect, and hopefully we will understand really what runtime environment means. So now let's spend a bit more time on V8. So as I already told you, V8 is a JavaScript engine that is inside Chrome. I think I didn't specify that Google is actually maintaining the V8, and that's really great because V8 receives many frequent updates, and many of those updates actually increase the V8 performance. And that's amazing because V8 is ultimately a part of Node.js, so Node.js as well receives frequent updates. And all that means pretty much is that over time Node.js, simply put, becomes faster and faster. Now, what I didn't mention is that V8 implements ECMAScript. Now, ECMAScript you can pretty much much think of the ECMAScript like specification behind JavaScript language. So whenever you use some construct in JavaScript or some rule in JavaScript, it is actually well defined in this ECMAScript. And when I say that V8 implements ECMAScript, I mean that V8 actually deeply understands JavaScript as a language. So next, what is also interesting is that V8 is actually written in C++, and that V8 can run standalone or it can be embedded into any C++ application. So when we put all of this together, this means that V8 is an engine that is written in C++, and remember, C++ is that highly performant, high-level, low-level programming language, which is really fast, and that engine can be embedded into any C++ application. So as it turns out, Node.js is a C++ application which has this V8 embedded, which is also written in C++. However, this V8 implements ECMAScript, meaning it understands JavaScript. So when you use JavaScript in Node.js, you aren't actually like running the JavaScript code on the server, but you're in fact using JavaScript to interface with the C++ in the end, which is kind of weird when you first think about it, but it's also really great because then you realize where that speed comes from. You're actually executing C++ application just using the language that is popular and you know, for example, or are learning at the moment. Okay, so hopefully you're still with me and hopefully the pieces are starting to connect now. So we have this image over here. On the left, you see something that you've seen previously, like this is our say like browser runtime environment which contains V8 engine, and on the right we have our Node runtime environment which also contains a V8 engine. So the difference is now what is here, like what this browser environment contains next to this V8 and what this Node runtime environment contains next to this V8. So over here we have stuff like document.querySelect, if you've ever done that. So that document object, that global object, is provided to us thanks to this browser environment and the entire DOM manipulations and things like that. And in this Node world we have different things now. We'll have utilities for working with the local file system, so on your server you'll be able to have different files and your server-side code can interact with those. We'll also have utilities for doing event-based things, and you'll learn about them in this series. So next, let's take an even closer look into what this Node actually contains. Okay, so Node is really huge project and it is open source, so you can take a look at the GitHub and see what makes it tick. However, if I had to like categorize what Node contains on a more like higher level, I'd say that it has a tool sections, it has libraries which are written in C++, and it also has like wrappers which are written in JavaScript for those C++ counterparts, so that you can use them inside of your Node applications while you're writing JavaScript code. So some of the popular libraries that it contains is, V8 engine, it has libuv, it has zlib, it has HTTP parser, it has SSL, and I know that I'm not explaining them, but unless you plan on contributing to the Node.js project, you really don't have to understand them too much, but of course you can, and that's always a good thing. I just don't want to drag this video too long. And on tools side, we have NPM, which we'll shortly learn about. We have GUP, which is necessary for building some dependencies, and we have something called gtest. Now I actually want to show you the open source Node.js repository so that you can actually see this picture and then see how they structure their project and then like try to make that connection. Okay, so this is the Node.js project repository, and first of all you can see that the latest commit on master was 21 hours ago, and they have different branches, so it's really active. You can see the number of commits, the number of contributors, the stars and forks, and yeah, it's pretty active repository. as you can tell. And now for more important things, we have a couple of key folders over here. So we have these deps, which stands for dependencies. We have this lib for libraries, and we have these tools for the tools. So these deps or dependencies contains all the C++ modules that Node.js contains. So if you open this folder, you have, for example, HTTP parser, you have zlib, V8, libuv, and for example, if you open the HTTP parser over here, you see that it is actually C++ code. So you have HTTP parser.c, HTTP parser.h, and if you open this, you can see the C++ code that actually makes this module over here. Okay, so hopefully you trust me more now, now that you've actually seen that it is actually C++. And now if I go back and actually go to this lib folder over here, you'll see that these are like JavaScript wrappers for the things you've potentially seen. So we had HTTP parser, and we have a couple of HTTP wrappers over here. And if I scroll down, you can see FS, for example. This is a module that you'll pretty frequently actually require in your JavaScript code. And if you open this, for example, over here, you'll see this weird mix of JavaScript and C++. So over here, you see this process.binding. It is actually loading the FS module, which is written in C++. But then you see that the rest of the code over here is written in JavaScript. So now you understand when you like use the FS module, which is provided to you thanks to Node, you are indeed like using JavaScript, and you are using it as if it has been built using JavaScript, but in fact, you're just like interfacing with the C++ module. So I thought that that was something quite neat, and it's funny how many people use Node daily and aren't aware of such things. So hopefully, you are now, and you're starting to really deeply understand what makes a Node.js tick. Okay, so right now we should totally understand the first two bullet points, and we should also understand this part over here where it says that Node.js is fast. However, we still didn't tackle the scalable part, as well as using this an event-driven non-blocking I/O model. Okay, so now we're going to tackle that I/O event-driven non-blocking model. And the main piece over there is pretty much the event loop. Now, explaining event loop is kind of tricky, and it's really not like a novice concept. Like, once you start learning Node.js, it really isn't that imperative for you to understand how event loop really works. In fact, I bet a lot of people who actually are proficient with Node.js don't really understand it. So what I'll do is the following. In this introductory video, I'll simply give you a good mental image of how Node.js's event loop affects your code. But if you're interested in like learning more about event loop, maybe like later, once you have more experience with Node.js, I will create a video that is like all about event loop, which will probably be a long one, and I'll also come back to this video and I'll put some notification over here. So if you're watching this from the future, please check this top right corner. Perhaps it has been already created, but if you are in present, like I am currently with this old technology, it's not uploaded yet. Okay, so for me to explain to you how event loop affects things, we need to introduce this call stack as a concept. Now, stack is simply like an abstract data structure. It has two operations only. You can push items onto it, and you can pop items from it. So for example, let's say you want to push a tree blocks in. Okay, you simply go like stack.push block one, it gets put over here. You do the same for the second one, it's over here, and the third one is over here. Now the interesting fact is when you want to retrieve the items, you cannot go like, okay, give me like the second block I put in. You can only retrieve the block that is on top of the stack. Okay, so for example, if you wanted to retrieve that second block, but there is also that third one on top of it, well, bad luck, because you first of all need to retrieve this third one, and only then you can retrieve that second block that you wanted. It is also called a first in, last out, because if you imagine, like, once you start putting items onto the stack, in order to get the first one, you need to pop all the previous ones first. Okay, so now that might seem like bizarre, like why would that limitation be advantageous at all, but as you'll see, it is a really great use case for this call stack. You can pretty much think of the call stack like a way for the application to remember what it is currently executing, what is going to happen once the current function is done, where it needs to return to, and stuff like that. And if it's all confusing so far, that's okay, because as soon as I go through these slides, it will make much more sense, because you'll see how things change over here. Okay, so now let's see what happens when our application over here starts executing. Okay, so the JavaScript will pretty much like scan this file from top to bottom. It will be aware of like variables, functions, definitions, declarations, stuff like that. So now you can imagine like your application just started running, that on this call stack we have something like the main. Now the main isn't really a concept in JavaScript, it is usually used in Java or C sharp or C++. However, we're simply using main over here to designate that, okay, this application right here is still running, like you just ran it, but it didn't like exit already, because there is some code that needs to be executed first and then it will like exit. So now the JavaScript will pretty much start executing it top to bottom, like the actual code, but because like these are just the functions which haven't been called yet, it will start on this line over here. And that's exactly what happens. So it sees this console.log function, which is called with this calculate Pythagora with these two arguments. Now I didn't mention, but we have these two functions over here. The first function is called square, and it simply accepts like one argument, and it simply returns that number multiplied by itself. And the second function is actually trying to calculate a Pythagorean theorem, which says like if you give me three numbers, the first squared plus second squared is equal to the third square. Now the mathematics really isn't important in this video, I just wanted to pick something that probably a lot of people are familiar with. So the second function simply does that by using the first function over here, and then this instruction over here simply calls it up with some actual numbers. And I'm also missing a closed brace over here, so this program wouldn't even run, but let's pretend that I didn't make this mistake. So onto this call stack of ours, this console.log function gets pushed and it is now on top. Now the JavaScript will see that we're actually calling this calculate Pythagorean theorem with these two arguments inside of this console.log statement, so it will push this function onto the stack, and then the execution will jump into this function over here. And that's exactly what happens. So we can see our call stack on the right, and we can see like this highlighted part is what currently is being executed. So now once we actually step into this function, we'll come to this first function call, which is simply calling this square function and passing this argument 10 over here, and that will be put onto the stack, and the execution will jump into this function. Okay, now we actually see the actual arguments over here, so it's pretty much the same thing, we just follow it, we use this number, we multiply it by itself, and then we return to the previous function. In the real life, by the way, each of these blocks over here remembers the address of a caller. So for example, caller of this function over here is this function. So once this is actually done via this return statement, it will know to jump back actually over here. Right, so we go back, the square of 10 gets popped because now we have that value, and you can almost imagine like instead of this square of a, you can imagine like being written like 100, because 10 by 10 is 100, but we still didn't calculate this right piece over here, so we're going to do that. So we again push this onto a stack and jump into this function once more. Now we calculate 12 squared, which is 144, and then we come back over here, we pop it of a stack, we pretty much have like return 100 plus 144, and then we're going to pop this function over here from the stack and simply get back to our console.log statement over here. And that's exactly what happens. And now the console.log statement can actually present this number to the user, so we'll pop it off. And in the real life, what would happen next is this application will terminate because there are no codes after this line over here. So this main will pop off the stack and your application will exit. So this is pretty much in a nutshell how every programming language works. Okay, so this is our like starting point. This should be something that makes sense. And then in contrast to this, we'll see how this event loop actually changes things inside of the Node.js. Okay, so now that we understand how like typical code executes, we need to spend some more time on what blocking I/O code really means. So I already told you a blocking I/O is like when you need to do some input output operation, which takes a while, so it blocks your other code. Okay, so for example, reading file from the hard drive, speaking via network, waiting for some request from some third party network services, stuff like that. So pretty much whenever CPU doesn't need to do something, but some other piece of hardware needs to, it gets really slow. So here I'm going to show you what this blocking code looks like, and we'll use this everything, like we'll use the same call stack, we'll use everything so that you can see like the difference. So let's pretend that we have this code over here. We simply have one function that is called do work. I know I'm really creative. And in that function, we simply read some file. In this case, we can pretend that we have some file called myfile.dat on our hard drive. And we simply read its contents and we store it in a variable that we called file. And then we console.log how we got here, which also shows my great debugging skills. So we start running this code, JavaScript does its thing, it recognizes that we have this function, that we have this function call over here, and it starts running, so we have this main on our call stack. Okay, so far so good. So then the execution actually jumps to this do work, and do work is going to be put onto a stack, and the execution is going to jump into this function. Okay, so it gets pushed into a stack, and we jump over here. Okay, then we go line by line, so we first see this line, and this line over here requires another function, which we can pretend is written somewhere else. So we need to call this function with this argument. So that is going to be put onto a call stack. Well, the issue is this operation takes a while, right? So we have no idea how long this takes, depends on how big this file is. So now, right now, our code is totally blocked, and this console.log statement really won't get executed unless this operation is done. So we wait some time, and then once it's done, it goes away, we go to this console.log, got here, and then we simply push that onto a stack. And once that is done, we return from this do work, we remove this do work from our call stack, and we're back onto me. Now, the thing with this code is it is really easy to understand. It's really readable, which is a good thing. However, as you have just seen, it is really slow, right? So you can definitely write this style of code in a Node.js. However, big difference between Node.js and some other, well, I wanted to say programming languages, but like, right, Node.js is a runtime environment. So if you were to use something like Ruby on Rails or Laravel or something like that, you would write this style of code, this blocking style of code. But how they're handling this is they will spawn multiple threads. And in Node.js, we don't use multiple threads, we just use one thread. That is why it is called a single threaded. But we use that event loop that we're going to learn about next. And you'll see how it allows us to do those slow operations without blocking our code. Okay, so this is the place where all should connect once we finish with this. So right now we are tackling that event-driven non-blocking I/O code. Okay, so before we move forward, I just want to mention a couple of things. So we have two key concepts here. One is called synchronous and the other is called asynchronous. Synchronous means that only one thing happens at a time, while asynchronous means many different things happen at the same time. same time. Okay, so now a few facts. Fact one, JavaScript is synchronous. JavaScript runtime can only do one thing at a time. So it pretty much processes the code sequentially. Now V8, the JavaScript engine, is also synchronous. So the V8 can only convert JavaScript to machine code, again, one thing at a time. However, the Node.js as a whole is asynchronous, because next to the V8, it contains many different things that we mentioned, and one of those things is libuv. Now, libuv is C++ module that is used to handle I/O in an event-driven non-blocking way. So now, this example over here is one that will be run asynchronously using the callbacks. So if you never seen callback before, callback is simply a function that you pass to another function with an idea of like call me back later once something happens. Okay, and over here our do work function calls this read file function. It passes it one argument, which is a file name, and then it passes it a function. Now I'm like at the same time both creating and passing this function over here, the so-called callback function, but you could have easily defined this function similarly to how we have this one and then simply pass in the function name. But in the Node.js, you'll usually see this pattern over here. Okay, so what's going on here? We call read file, we say it read my file.dat, and when you're done, execute this function with this statement over here, and you see that we're passing this data. Well, this read file function will actually pass this data, and it will pass the contents of my file.dat. Now you're probably wondering, like, how should you know that? Well, we're pretending to use some function over here from the Node.js core modules, and there are couple of pretty much like exactly these functions that read a file for you, and then inside of your callback they automatically pass as a first argument the actual data. So the callback next contains this console.log file read, and we also output the content of, okay, sorry, this should say data over here, so this is my mistake, so data, and we want to output the contents of data. And then over here, entirely separately, we have this console.log got here. Again, my great debugging skills. Okay, now over here, we still have this call stack, right? And you can imagine, like for this example, this call stack being part of the V8. Okay, so this is V8 over here pretty much, but we have two additional panels over here. So one panel is event queue, and another panel you can think of like operating system doing stuff. And I'll explain what you mean as we go further. And this red interesting symbol over here is pretty much our event loop. So this is like the tiniest piece ever. Now these parts over here are like libuv, and this part on the left, the call stack, is V8's property, more or less. Okay, so now let's jump into it. So what's going to happen is we execute this code and we get to this do work function call. Okay, great. So that gets pushed to our V8 call stack. And I'm intentionally now mentioning this V8 more and more because I want to make this separation clear in your mind that V8 is just one piece of a puzzle. We also have many different core C++ modules in Node.js, and libuv is the one responsible for doing the I/O operations with your operating system. So now the execution jumps to this function, and we dig a bit deeper into it. We first of all see this read file call. Now this read file over here is a function that we get out of the box thanks to Node.js. We have many different modules there, and one of those modules is for handling files. So this is pretty much a JavaScript wrapper for our C++ code that ultimately interacts with our operating system using libuv in an event-based way. Okay, so our V8 call stack registers our intention here, and that's OS operation, because anything input output wise is OS operation, starts as executing. So now you see we have this parallel, like this is our JavaScript in V8 and this is our C++ modules in Node.js. So now while we're going to go through a couple of steps over here executing JavaScript line by line, this over here read file will actually use libuv, your operating system, your hard drive, and etc. to actually load that file. And that is done in event based way. So once this is actually done, our libuv will actually receive that, okay, file has been read and can do something next. But for now, let's stick into this V8 world. So next, what's going to happen is we simply execute the next JavaScript code, okay? It is the console log got here. So, okay, let's execute it. We put it on the stack, we execute it. And then let's pretend that while we were executing this console.log, that our operating system just informed the libuv that file has been read. And now what libuv did is it took our callback that we defined over here and put it inside of something called event queue. Now libuv is trying to push this callback onto our call stack. However, because JavaScript and V8 is synchronous, it cannot do both of these operations at once. So V8 needs to continue with whatever it is currently doing in our call stack. And only when it is empty will the event loop over here, this little red guy, will push this callback to the call stack. So we go on, we just executed this console.log statement. And then we are finally done with the work as far as V8 is concerned. And we pop that off of the stack as well. Now the call stack is empty. I mean, you still see this main, but I mean, our application is still running. That is simply to designate that our application hasn't terminated yet. So now in the next cycle, or like whatever cycle happens right now, the libuv's event loop will figure out that, okay, call stack is empty. Now I can take this callback and push it onto a call stack, and it does that. So now all of a sudden we have this callback on our call stack, and I like highlighted this callback in particular. So then V8 is like, okay, I know how to do my job. I'll simply execute JavaScript code one by one, and it finds this line over here. It simply puts it onto a call stack once again. It outputs that, then it gets popped off a call stack. Now the callback has completed and we pop it off. And then if you didn't have any other code, finally the main will pop off as well and your application or process will terminate. So I hope that now you understand that Node.js is far, far, far more than just JavaScript. It actually has that multiple pieces working together. So when you go on and read that JavaScript is synchronous, yes, it is, but you need to understand that ultimately we're communicating with our C++ modules. And that brings me to this screen. So if we take a look now, all of these bullet points should hopefully now totally make sense. So this is exactly what I want to do in this video. So I didn't want to just like list what you usually see on the internet, but I also wanted to explain all of them in details. So hopefully that now you have this great Node.js foundation, and when you go on and learn more about Node.js and start working with different built-in modules and a lot of different things, really, you have this solid foundation so that you can build on top of it. And before I finish this video, I just want to cover one more thing, and that is how you can actually get this node that we have spent all this time talking about. So if you just Google Node.js, the first link is nodejs.org, and if you click on this site, this is the Node.js's homepage. Now what Node.js team does is they release two different versions. So at all times you have a version which is LTS, meaning long-term support, and you have this other version which is like most up-to-date, but they don't really support it that long. So the idea is if you want to use Node.js for any like client work or for your own application that will be eventually deployed and you want to like maintain it and to have users, you should use LTS version, at least on that server. However, if you're just playing around, learning around, and you really want to learn those newest features that are coming into the Node.js, you can't go wrong with this other version. So that pretty much explains that. And once you click on any of this, really, if you're on the Windows, you'll get .exe file and you just install it like you would usually install anything, really. And if you're like on Linux or macOS, the installation is slightly different, but you should have no problems there, really. And that's it, guys. So you can install it. I cannot install it because I have already installed it, but yeah, you probably know how to do it anyways. Okay, guys, so this is the end of this video. I hope you learned something, and I definitely hope that it wasn't too confusing. If you have any questions, however, please leave them down in the comments below. And as always, if you like this video, you can give it a thumbs up. If you hated this video for whatever reason, you can do the thumbs down, although I hope you wouldn't do that. And if you really like this video, you can also subscribe so that you'll be notified whenever I produce a new video. Thanks for watching as always, and I'll see you in the next video.